Thank you. just bless her and her family. Thank you for all they poured into Impact Chapel. And I ask you for your help now. And I thank you in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. As we're being seated, we're going to go ahead and dismiss the children for Children's Church. If the child is old enough to send them, go ahead. If they can go to the potty on their own, go ahead and send them. And we don't have an age cap at this time. We're just trying to do this every so often. So today we're going to learn about Noah's Ark, the colors of the rainbow from a biblical perspective, and have a craft along with that. And thanks for being here. This is our second Sunday of the month here. We're going into Father's Day next week. So come on out. We're going to have a special prize drawing for fathers. It's going to be something cool, like something manly, either a chainsaw or a DeWalt toolkit or something. We want you to get involved with that. So you've got to be here, folks. Bring a neighbor and call a friend. Come on out for that on this Father's Day. And then the following week, which is the fourth Sunday every month, we have our beach service at Haleiwa Ali'i Beach Park. That's left by the boat docks. We don't have a specific spot, but we do have a reservation, so they'll give us that spot. We'll put it out. All our information is on Facebook, so if you head over to Impact for God on Facebook, and we'll keep that fresh. We also put our videos from the service today. You can link people to them. You can link it, Scott, so you can have your family watch me sing. One. I know that might be embarrassing. Sam, me too. And Sam says he's going to continue to join us until they get settled in their new location. So make sure you say goodbye to them today. We also have plaques and some pictures out there to sign. I know the conference is your last service as well. And we said some farewells, but make sure that you have the opportunity to sign that. So without further ado, what do we have? What else do we have next? Do we have special music for today? No special music for today? How about testimonies? Lord, done anything good in your life this week? Of course. I know you're smiling. What's God done good for you this week? I'll give you one. This morning I learned that I'm going to have a second grandchild in February. More importantly, I asked my son and my daughter-in-law to FaceTime. You guys in church now? Oh yeah, Dad, we found a church. We have some friends that are going to church locally. And I hope there's an answer to prayer, right? To see your children walk in faith. What about you? Who's got a blessing to share?
Everybody's looking around.
What you got? Tell us.
So lately we've been having really bad car troubles, and so our truck kind of really just kind of on us. And so this week we were able, the Lord blessed us with a car that came from a friend that we know, and yeah. They were moving out, and they said, hey, you know, if you want to go ahead and get this car, glad to give it to you. So I was like, wow, because out of nowhere, you know, we've been having this trouble, and then the Lord's just blessed us with it.
Wow, that's good. Blessed with the car. And the old one, you can just leave it on the streets. This year, it'll give
it to us. That's good.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. Thanks for sharing that. Who else? Anyone? Bless you this week. Isaac, what about you? Working at the TSA now? Hey, thanks for being here. We have some visitors, first-timers, and some return from AMR back in the past when Chaplain Schaffner had the service in 2018, and now you're here, so thanks for that. Good to see you. Chaplain Conner? All right. Bless you. Go back to church.
All right. I'm going to do this one last time here. Check, 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 check. Y'all can hear me in the back.
All right, so here, as he said, I'm going to PCSing this week. My family's actually already in Charlottesville, Virginia. So we've been thinking a lot about decisions and choices you make every day. And the truth of the matter is, something drives It takes a lot of energy. Yeah, it's like a conductor, and absorbs it, kind of insulates it from this. I don't know how long we can sit here, maybe ready with people. But it can absorb it. It can kind of take the heat, and it starts to take away the moment. And so the point of the message today is, the text today we're going to be in is in Daniel chapter 6. If you have a Bible, it's on page 630. The title of the message is The One Habit of Highly Effective Christians. One Habit of Highly Effective Christians. And we're going to look at today what we might fear in life on bread, what we must fear in life, and then what we most fear in life. And these decisions come generally every day, whether we like it or not. But Daniel's going to teach us this, obviously, from this chapter. It's not how to win friends and influence people, as me and Scott talked about yesterday, but that this one thesis of the sermon is that prayer is the most regular thing in your life. It will regulate everything in your life. If prayer is the most regular thing in your life, it's going to regulate everything in your life. And we're going to look at Daniel chapter 6, which is often relegated to the children's church. So I'm going to ask you to kind of think about this story like you've never read it before. But I'm going to tell you that ahead of time. Daniel's on the menu for a bunch of lions. But the story's not about lions. It's not about Daniel. It's ultimately about how God honors faithfulness. So we're going to read Daniel 6 a little bit. We'll slowly walk through the chapter, and then I will pray. I'm going to start in verse chapter 5, actually, where we're going to start. That's where the Aramaic starts. And Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62. It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators of the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Let us pray. Oh, if it is true that you are the unchanging God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. God, I pray for you in this moment, have time to reflect on what you're doing in your life. May we see what we fear and lay it at your feet, knowing that we change often, you never change. Never pray. Amen. So we're going to talk about what we might fear in this life. But first we've got to get a little bit of context, because we're going to hop into the book of Daniel, chapter 6. And Daniel, we're about 6th, 7th century B.C. Babylonians there, they're big kids, little kids on the block, strong empire. And they have taken over the southern kingdom of Judah to kind of export this grain trust. So they've taken out all these leaders. And I'm going to drop a kind of heavy, significant point on you. John Lennox and Against the Flow. He is professor emeritus of mathematics at Oxford. He says this, that Daniel's been assimilated. And there's one key point that you shouldn't overlook in this chapter. His name is Daniel. Now you may not kind of understand what that's about, but when you look and read throughout the book, you start to realize, okay, Daniel 1 through 6, he started out as a teen, maybe 15 or so, now he's worked his way up to 70s, 60s, 70s. And this empire is taken over. And what you have is Daniel, his name is Belteshazzar. God is my judge, named Daniel is the meaning, but Bel is my protector. They try to change his name. They try to assimilate him. So Daniel Lennox kind of says, say that at the outset, because if you're not used to reading these kind of stories, you may think, oh, this is the dude I need to be like Daniel. I need to be kind of heroic and courageous, but a more Christocentric reading that focuses on God and Christ, and that this is what God has done to preserve his people in hard times. And that's an important lesson for us at the outset. But it says that Daniel's, again, is 120 satraps, he's in the top three. And if that helps you to kind of picture Star Wars, the Galactic Empire, like all the pods, and he's in front of, Senator Palpatine, whatever. That's kind of the picture. So as we go to verse 3, we see this Daniel became distinguished above all that we talked about. That's the only use, actually, in the tenses that he continued to distinguish himself. The only time in the Bible that says that. What a way to be described. And then verse 4, the high officials and satraps sought to find a ground for complaint against Daniel. The guards of the kingdom, they could find no ground for complaint, no fault. This man is faithful. Verse 6, these high officials and satraps came in agreement and said, oh, King Darius, live forever. All the high officials of the kingdom, the prefects, the satraps, the counselors, the governors, all agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes a petition to any god or man for 30 days, except to you, O king, should be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish this injunction and sign it. Sign the document so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be revoked. Then the king signed the injunctions. Now, we all know politicians and kings that either are more corrupt, or they do no wrong, right? In our eyes, they do nothing. And Daniel is neither of those. In this kind of conspiracy witch hunt, you see they looked at his private life and couldn't find anything against him. They looked again at his public life and had nothing to do with against him. So then this new king elevates Daniel to the number two man in the number one empire in the world. So then the plot rises, though. They kind of hatch this scheme. Okay, I know we're going to try to put a wedge between sweep clean. So how are we going to get him? They have this plan. All right, prayer. This is kind of this thing. And this is kind of where we get to our first point of what we might fear in life. We might fear a number of things, but you can kind of just see for these people of what they might fear. They call them the exile. They call people the exile of Judah in verse 13. And so in some ways, we start to see prejudice writ large, which many of us face in a number of days. It's important to remember. For them, this loss of power is a reveal. And the image doesn't make anything to fear. But for Daniel, here he is. This again, he's an old dude at this point. Very old man. Will he compromise, right? Because now he's got to choose. I'm in a prestigious spot. It's kind of safe at the end of my life, right? And then, not only that, they're just asking me to not pray in public. You got to kind of slow the narrative down. Like, well, I guess even in prayer, I could kind of center my breath, close my eyes, coming out of my closet, no one can see me. Will he compromise? I love what Christopher Wright says. He says, there never comes a time in life where we can sit back and think that our faithfulness to God is so well established that it can never be challenged or tested again. Never comes a time in life. You're not going to be tested. And for you that may be older sitting here, I suppose it could be tempting to carry into life that's like, oh, I'm good. I've served God faithfully for years. I can ease off the pedal a little bit, not make disciples, not do what I'm told to do, command to do. And I encourage you, again, whether it's your 50s, your 60s, your 70s, to run with the same perseverance that you're told to run with, to continue to be faithful. As a reminder, again, what we might lose in life, what we value. Like the students, the young cats have to ask themselves on the day of bread, how am I valuing my decisions at work, at school, wherever it may be, in college? Like, how do I evaluate what I should prioritize, value or not? And often it comes down to fear. What do I fear I might lose? How do I fear I might be seen in front of others? And that, so this really happens whether you're 8 or 88. Tempted. There's a moment that comes that kind of you have to ask yourself, what am I fear? This boils down to what do you value in this life? So Daniel's giving us, the text is giving us a picture of what we fear. And then it continues on in the story, verse 10. 10. Now, when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. 3 times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about this royal decree. Do we not publish the decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or man except to you should be cast into the lions? The king answered, the decree stands in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, not being repealed. And they said, Daniel, who was one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king. He prays 3 times a day. And the king heard this and was greatly distressed and was determined to rescue Daniel and make every effort from somehow. So what does Daniel do? He doesn't pace around nervous and anxious and crave. He doesn't conceal it though, right? Again, since the window is open, anybody that wanted to see could. It's not a one-off. This is ritualistic. It's not a flare prayer and shoot up a quick prayer to God. This is his pattern that's even done 3 times a day, as he had done before, year after year. And so it's very ritualistic. So it reminds us in life that the scriptures, oftentimes with the will of God, we get so frustrated in PCS decisions. I'm not sure if the church is going to do this or do that. How do we handle this decision in life when we kind of get anxious and fear takes over and the fight or flight thing in the brain kind of goes, hey, starts talking to you? And we are told what to do in scripture often, right? We know we should pray, but we don't. But we do take that work decision, take the relationship decision, we kind of push it down. We also kind of try to juggle like our image or how we look forward to retirement, and money becomes a factor, and we kind of like keep pushing things. Now, how are you? How are you doing? Oh, good, man. You think things are going all right? Yeah, fine. You know, just you know, trying to hide everything that's really going on instead of just Ephesians 5, right? On all kinds of occasions, pray. You got Philippians, do nothing. Do not be anxious about everything, but everything in prayer, petition, make a request to the Lord of God. You need to pray. Colossians, devote yourself to prayer. 1 Thessalonians, rejoice always. Pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances. This is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. 1 Peter, don't push it down. Cast your anxieties on him, for he cares for you. We're told what to do often. We're told how we can absorb this fear instead of letting it build up and transfer the heat, but we don't. And so it's ritualistic. But then he also moves on. He's on his knees when he prays. He focuses his whole mind and his whole body on praying. I tried to harvest kind of look at me funny earlier this morning because I had my iPhone come this out. And I was like, okay, it's actually Jerusalem's better. And so technically we need to move all these chairs and focus it that way. And chapel cushions, I'm not advocating we do that. I'm just like to move the whole service and worship band over there. But that's kind of the question you can ask. Why does he have to face Jerusalem? And what he's kind of helping us understand is that it matters in the orientation of his harvest. See, Daniel actually, a while back, he could have gone back to his homeland. When the exiles returned, he could have left and know the whole story of God. He chose to be faithful. Be in the army unit, and with these pagan kings, I'm going to serve faithfully to the end. So he's again, he's oriented his heart. We have time to check out 1 Kings 8, where this kind of stems from. So it's a reminder, it matters in your heart. Now, just in case that didn't hit home, like, okay, if you're maybe married, you know, imagine, say, Sam, you know, you go home, and what happens? Like, she says, hey, tonight, come do some things, and like, no, I'm just not in the mood. You know, but my heart, I'm just there to be my heart. I can't imagine, but I don't know if I'm going to touch anything like that. No, just go ahead and rub it in there, right? Touching doesn't matter. What you do with your body, it doesn't matter. Maybe the head's going a little bit better. Anyways, that's kind of what you see here. Like, you may get slapped in the face. Things may go sour fast, and we have those moments of our body not being connected. It matters. You do with your body because it begins to mold your affections, even when you don't want to do things sometimes. And so we can see Daniel prostrate himself on the ground. Maybe it doesn't the back. And they see Mark. He's being faithful. And for the diner on death row, now he's dinner on death row. They're going to cast him in the line into the den. And so it matters what your heart believes. What is going to win the day at the end of the day? You can't serve the two masters. If you want to choose money in the end, that will win the day. And the love of the Lord will wane. If you want to advance your career, get on my phone, go to work, and I'll give full attention to my boy. And the family can be split. But there's different things that matter over time. And Daniel's helping us see what we must ultimately fear in this life and not lose. And so the story continues. But first, you have to also see these sidetracks, the words, they snitch on Daniel. But here is this king. He's got all the power. He's the man in charge. But what's the point of being a king if you can't change laws and book laws? So you see five times this kind of weird thing that says the law of the Medes and Persians cannot be changed. Verse 8, 12, 15, 17. And you think if he was emperor, he could have absolute power, but really the emperor has no clothes on. So we see who's actually in charge here, though. And where what you ultimately must fear. And so verse 14, the king, when he heard these words, was much distressed and set his mind to deliver Daniel. Verse 15, his men came by Daniel and said to the king, no, this cannot be changed. Verse 16, the king commanded, and Daniel was cast into the den of lions. The king declared to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve continually, deliver you. Stone was brought, laid on the mouth of the den. The king sealed it with his own signet ring. And with the singing of the Lord, so that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. And the king went to his palace, spent the night fasting, no diversions were brought to him, and sleep fled from his men. And then at the break of the day, the king arose. He went in haste to the den of lions. As he came near to the den of lions, where Daniel was, he cried in a tone of anguish. The king declared, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God whom you serve the lines. You can imagine that. Are you there? And just, no one was he expecting it. The MGM lions kind of like, no, I'm actually half dead. You know, what is going on? You can picture him getting pulled up, sitting beside the king, looking at the king. He hasn't slept. Man, king, you know, like, I had a fluffy pillow all night. You're looking pretty rough right now. And but you think you're rough. And those lions, they had this tasty morsel all night, and they couldn't eat. Rough. But you know, again, why lions couldn't eat Daniel, right? He was all backbone. But Daniel heard, 21, said, oh, king, live forever. My God sent me an angel to shut the lion's mouth and make it not harm me, because I was not blameless before you, O king. I have done no harm. The king was exceedingly glad, commanded that Daniel be taken out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, no harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. The king commanded those who maliciously accused Daniel were cast into the den of lions, and their children were lost. Before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them, broke all their bones in pieces. And King Darius wrote to all the people, nations, languages, and dwell in the earth, peace multiplied and make it a decree in all the world. Commanded the people were to fear and tremble before the God of Daniel. For he is a living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be to the end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus of Persia. Daniel was saved in the lion's den, not from the lion's den. We should at times expect suffering as a Christian. But we also have to remember the Christian character is not just forged in the moment of adversity, but it's revealed. But the beautiful thing about Daniel praying year after year after year after year, it gets easier. But there's also some encouragement that we can take away from the story, which I love, that it's not just about Daniel, like it says, it's about a greater Daniel. Because the parallels in this story are striking. Daniel, government officials, jealous of his power and authority, plot to kill him. Jesus, religious officials, jealous of his power and authority, plot to kill him. Daniel, no charge can be found against him except to do with his God. Jesus, no charge can be found against him, so they accuse him of blasphemy against God. Daniel faces the ruler of the Persian Empire, and he's anguished by the fact that he would have to go with the lions and tries to save what he can. Jesus faces the representative of Pilate in the Roman Empire, and tries to release him several times, but he can't even though he's innocent. Daniel faces certain death, thrown into the den, the stone is rolled away, bringing death and darkness, ostensibly. Jesus dies on a cross, is laid in the tomb, the stone is rolled over for death and darkness. Daniel, through the power of God, defies death. The stone is rolled away, he comes out alive, and is vindicated and released, and he's restored to the position and he prospers in the Persian kingdom. Jesus rises from the dead. 3 days later, the stone is rolled away. Sin and death are defeated. He is vindicated. He is elevated and he is seated at the right hand of God in power and glory of the kingdom. Daniel is not hearing the story of Oz. So we're reminded of Hebrews. Therefore, let us throw off the sin that so easily entangles us. And let us run the race with perseverance, fixing our eyes on the author and perfecter of our faith. Scorning the cross and focus on what we see seated at the right hand of God. So I pray that that would be your story, that you would see that power of God on display, and that through death, life will come. So let's pray. Father, I pray that we would not be taken captive to fear, but to faith. And that often when we feel like you aren't meeting our needs, we get fearful, scared, we get frustrated, we think your hands are tied behind our back and we can't do anything. But God, I pray that we would be reminded that you are in control. The unchanging God. And so God, I pray that we realize every good perfect gift comes from above, for you don't change like shifting shadows. And your Father has left you. Thank you.
Next week is our Father's Day service. It's a special service dedicated to the dads in our congregation, followed by the last Sunday of the lunch, the month, which will be our beach service at Haleiwa Ali Beach Bar. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you for speaking for John this morning, God. We know that with military lifestyle comes anxiety, God. But God, when I think about anxiety, I want to come back to your word of Philippians 4:7, where it says, "The peace of God, which passes all comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." So, Father, as many of us go into PCS season, as many of us, like myself, are preparing for our families for a few months, for some pathways, God, I just pray that you would just give us that peace that comes from you, Father, that you would go before us, that you give us confidence, God, and that you would set us on this path, and that you are with us all, Lord, where we go. God, we love you. We praise your name. In the name of Jesus Christ, and I pray this morning, amen. Have a great weekend. Thank you for being here, everyone.
Thank you. Right? Yeah. Left eye? Well, I got 240 pounds on me, so.
I'm not asking how much you can lift. I know how much.
What are we talking? What lift?
Huh?
What lift?
Hey, Leon! Leon,
is something
wrong?
I'm not done.
Oh, you're not?
No, I'm not done yet. I'll see you.
Hey, Levi, I'm leaving in 3 minutes.
Trace, Levi.